I was in the wrong Zoom room, it turns out.
Oh, no.
I got too many links that I'm just, so I was like sitting very patiently waiting for, I do apologize for that. But I think it'll go all right. Thank you for everyone for coming. Thanks for logging in. I know we all have lots to do these days, and it's really nice to have all of you here. As Catherine mentioned, I am presenting on part of my book project, which does look at Egyptian religion in Greece more broadly. But I was really interested in kind of exploring the problem of Macedonia in particular, and talking a little bit more about my ideas of globalization. And that's sort of the genesis of this talk. So with that, I will begin. In his mid-second century CE treatise on Isis and Osiris, the Greek philosopher Plutarch made the seemingly impossible claim that Isis is a Greek word, elenikon gar Isis esti. Plutarch's claim relies on a dubious linguistic and philosophical analogy between Isis's name and the Greek word oida, or I know. But as a Greek living under Roman rule, Plutarch's claim has a broader resonance. By laying claim to a goddess whose identity is so deeply intertwined with Egypt, a place that is decidedly not in Greece, Plutarch is performing a bit of colonizing himself. While it's easy to see this phrase as a hyperbolic claim by a writer who is singularly concerned with the advancement of Greek claims of cultural supremacy, Plutarch's attitude was part of a bigger movement in Roman Greece, including in the less frequently studied region of Macedonia. This paper explores the many ways that Isis's devotees in Macedonia redefined the goddess and her retinue as part of the Greek pantheon. An earlier adopter of Isiac cults, Macedonia and its array of well-preserved texts, sculptures, and sanctuaries offers us an ideal opportunity to explore a religious history on a small scale. But this area also needs further investigation as a Roman province. Macedonia has largely been left out of our current archaeological and historical narratives of the Eastern Roman Empire. Indeed, this province suffers from the same assumption that somehow the Roman Empire effected no change upon it that plagues studies of the Eastern Empire as a whole. As attention to Roman Achaia has grown in recent years due to the popularization of second sophistic literary studies, Macedonia, with its lack of a well-defined literary corpus, has not received that same attention. Though there are some great historical studies, namely those by people like Adonis Rizakis and Jean de Mai, they've really been able to emphasize the key role that Macedonia plays in these Mediterranean-wide networks of trade, connectivity, social engagement, but we still don't really have a clear sense of how Macedonians themselves are understanding their place within this increasingly connected Roman world. In this paper, I seek to address this gap by exploring how Macedonians and Macedonian devotees of Isis in particular, place themselves in the Roman Mediterranean through the practice of Isiac cults. I study these shifts through the lens of deterritorialization, which can be defined briefly as a globalizing process that involves uprooting part of a culture and placing it in a new cultural and geographic context. Isis and her companions have long histories in Egyptian culture, and in many versions of late period and Ptolemaic myths are deeply connected with Egypt's natural landscape as well. Isis is the mountains, Osiris and Serapis are the Nile. What then does it mean when we take these cults and gods and put them in a new place? Now to explore this question, I'm going to define first the concept of deterritorialization and explore its relationship with globalization on the whole. Many scholars like Tamar Hodos, Michael Pitts and Michael John Verisluis have advanced globalization as a vital new framework for exploring cultural contact and change in the Roman Empire. But there has been little recognition of the fact that globalization, in fact, refers to a broad range of strategies and actions that each has their own meaning and applicability. By focusing on globalization's constituent parts, as I will today, we can more effectively adapt this broad-ranging idea, grounded in modern understandings of global capital, into an interpretive, useful tool for our study of the past. Next, I will turn to the Isiac cult of Macedonia, beginning with a brief history of the cult's history in the Greek world. From there, I will examine the textual evidence from Macedonia, specifically an epigraphic hymn from Maronea that was thought to be part of Isiac rites. This text deterritorializes Isis by highlighting a special relationship with Greece and placing her in the same myth that Demeter occupies in the Homeric hymns. Next, I will turn to the material world and look at how Macedonian cultic communities grounded Isis in the Greek world. In the case of sculptures, Isis was carved in Greek materials and styles rather than importing statues or materials from Egypt. In building sanctuaries, these communities chose natural landscapes that echoed the marshy delta or brought water into sanctuaries in ways that were meant to evoke the Nile. The material world of Isis worship then was meant to domesticate the Nile and render Isis as a Macedonian deity in form and substance. But it also highlights the deep connections that some Macedonians had with Achaia and emphasizes the fundamental role that these trans-regional ideas of Greekness played in the organization of identity in Roman Macedonia. So before we begin with the ancient material, it's really necessary to define deterritorialization and its place in these broader discussions of globalization. In this paper, I'm using deterritorialization to describe ancient objects and ideas of places that have been uprooted from their original context, retaining only a tenuous or weakened connection with their point of origin. As a consequence of this separation, they may be associated with new place or even in some cases remain entirely unmoored. Deleuze and Guattari famously coined this term in their seminal work, A Thousand Plateaus, where it refers to the process in which empires remove material flows from their placement on Earth. These cultural forms then become part of the imperial force and serve as a form of communication between the conquered and the conquered. Sorry, the conqueror and the conquered. Deterritorialization, to summarize their view quite briefly, breaks habits and patterns, forming a very deep rupture. Though Deleuze and Guattari were primarily interested in contemporary experiences of capitalism, anthropologists and sociologists studying the past have adapted this concept to talk about the phenomenon of weakened ties between culture and place or geography. Arjun Appadurai looks at the role of material culture and heritage in this process and argues that deterritorialization is a process of distancing that intensifies when people are able to imagine the cultural conditions of others through media. This renders the foreign into a familiar part of daily life, but it also makes it difficult for the receiving culture to retain its previous form of cultural self-understanding. But fundamentally, deterritorialization is a function of Anthony Giddens' phenomenon of space-time compression, a way that migration and other cultural flows disrupt human experiences of time, distance, and place. In a Roman context, deterritorialization has to be understood as part of a larger discussion of cultural change and experiences of empire that come out of the Romanization debates of the 1990s and early 2000s. Now, I do not need to summarize these debates at length for the present audience, but it is worth noting that many scholars have pointed to globalization as the way forward. Globalization does have a few key advantages over Romanization. It does not automatically center Roman culture and worldviews. It emphasizes the multivalence and particularity of each local and regional experience. And it offers a more precise set of terms that can be used to describe distinct aspects of change and permanence that ancient empires produced. In studies of ancient globalization, deterritorialization is often cast as the key part of global culture. Indeed, Pitts and Verslewis focus their definition of globalization on deterritorialization and see it as one of the two key processes that drive cultural change in the Roman world. For this paper then, I'm going to consider Issyic religion and religious culture across Macedonia as an example of deterritorialization and its companion process, reterritorialization. In these next sections, I will explore the artistic and cultural mechanisms through which devotee communities removed Isis from Egypt and then placed her into Greece. Rather than reterritorialization, however, I will use the metaphor of grounding. This term is not just more pleasing to the ear. It alludes to a process of stabilization, of potential for future change and growth, to an embodied and experiential version of recreating foreign forms in local and familiar ways. Most of all, it recognizes that consumption happens not just at the moment of contact, but through generations to come. So turning now to the ancient material, let's explore the first half of this process. So how did Isis come to Greece? From the Bronze Age onward, Egyptians lived in Greece and Greeks lived in Egypt. Migration is probably the sole human constant, and these two communities had strong relationships. The first known instance of Egyptian religion in Greece happens in the 5th century BCE. In an inscription found in the Athenian port of Piraeus, a group of Syrians argued that they should be allowed to found a temple to their goddess Astarte because the Egyptians were allowed to found one for their main goddess, Isis. As far as we can tell, and admittedly that's not very far, it seems that these early sanctuaries primarily served Egyptian immigrants living in Greece, and that rather few people of Greek origin participated. But that began to change very rapidly at the end of the 4th century BCE, a period when migration around the Mediterranean intensifies. Epigraphic evidence attests to a small number of Egyptian priests leaving Egypt at around the same time, that end of the 4th century, beginning of the 3rd century period. And many of them came to Greece, where they founded new sanctuaries dedicated to the Egyptian gods Isis, Serapis, Anubis, and Harpocrates. Our best evidence for this comes from a small Egyptian sanctuary founded on the island of Delos. Inside this one very small basement sanctuary was found a column with two poems inscribed on it, referred to in the scholarly literature as the Chronicle of Serapeion A. The two poems, though written by different people, tell basically the same story. An Egyptian priest named Apollonius from the city of Memphis at one point decided to gather some objects and sail to Delos. When he arrived, he founded a small sanctuary to the Egyptian gods within his house. The priesthood was then passed down to his son and his grandson, who continued to grow this cultic community. Though the chronicle itself is quite unique, we do have attestations of individual Egyptian priests and priestesses founding the cult in other key port cities around the same time, including our friend here, Ouafres, son of Horus, who's thought to be from Posiritis, who came to Demetrius sometime in that late 4th, early 3rd century BCE. We also have similar sort of grave reliefs or dedications at Amphipolis in Macedonia and Argos in Arglid. Now, there's no evidence that these people know each other, much less that they even know about each other. And it's unclear whether this was part of some sort of concerted royal effort launched by the Ptolemaic kingdom. Instead, I have argued that we should see this sort of initial diaspora as a product of increasing connectivity across the Hellenistic Mediterranean. Now, Macedonia in particular played a very key role in this popularization of Egyptian cults in the Eastern Mediterranean. Shortly after the foundation of the Egyptian cult at Amphipolis in the late 4th century BCE, a second sanctuary was founded at Thessaloniki, which very quickly came under royal control. Philippi's sanctuary appeared in the 3rd century BCE, and Dion's appeared in the 2nd. During this early Roman period, so we might think of this like 1st century BCE, 1st century AD, sanctuaries appear in Veria, Nicaea, Stobi, Cassandrea, and by the 2nd century CE at Heraclea as well. Just a bit to the east of this map is the site of Maronea, which also plays an important role in this discussion, and I'll discuss in more length later. Epigraphic evidence actually indicates a high level of interconnectivity between these religious communities, both within Macedonia, as attested in prosopographical studies, and elsewhere in Greece. In one example from Opus in Boeotia, a man named Xenaitos slept at the sanctuary of Thessaloniki and received a dream command to found a sanctuary back at Opus. This text, which he dedicated in Thessaloniki, indicates that the smaller Isiac communities around the region valued connections to larger and more famous sanctuaries, and that these relationships were considered to be reciprocal in some way. Moreover, it emphasizes the connections between Isiac religious communities across provincial boundaries. So they have these relationships not just within their sort of neighboring sites, but across the Mediterranean. Now, alongside their own mythologies of the cult's histories, devotees also created a surprisingly cohesive theology of Isis herself through a series of hymns dedicated throughout the Eastern Mediterranean. These hymns, often called eratologies, describe Isis's powers, familial relationships, and remarkable acts. Macedonian examples are known from Maronea, Thessaloniki, and Cassandrea, making Macedonia actually one of the regions with the highest concentration of these eratological texts. The majority were dedicated in the 1st century BCE and are actually very close copies to each other, sometimes even word for word. Ian Moyer has studied the epigraphy of these dedications, and he's actually demonstrated something really significant. He's proven that they are actually punctuated in the exact same way. And they were probably set up in very easily accessible parts of these sanctuaries. So what does this mean? This means that these texts are probably actually written as part of a ritual, that they would have been read out loud, and the punctuation kind of helps keep a particular rhythm. Again, pointing to a large degree of cohesion between Isiac communities throughout the Eastern Mediterranean. So let's look at this Maronea example to get a clear sense of what these texts entails. Part one, the opening prayer, establishes the dedicatory context of the inscription, thanking Isis for her help in resolving the dedicator's eye problem. Part two, the description of Isis's family, redefines her as the first daughter of Gaia, the companion of Serapis, and the cosmic counterpart of Selene. The third and final part of this Marinia eratology lists Isis's powers. Most of these attributes of Isis do appear in these other Greek eratologies, including one from Chime in Asia Minor, one from the island of Andros, and one from Medinet Mahdi in Egypt, as well as a literary reconstruction in Diodorus Siculus. So this suggests again that there is a real consistency in her theology across a broad swath of the Eastern Mediterranean. At Meroni in particular, Isis is praised as a discoverer of writing in tandem with Hermes, the inventor of justice and the creator of Greek and barbarian languages, as a lawgiver, and as the divinity who defined familial values. The overall impression here is that of a cultic community striving to contextualize Isis and Egyptian religion in the Greek mythological past. First, the goddess is credited with tasks normally associated with particular Greek deities, the creation of laws and justice, which is Athena's job, and the definition of familial roles and productive female fertilities, which is Hera's job. This is the first type of grounding that we see in Greek mythology, a revision of the pantheon of divine powers such that Isis holds a central role. But Isis is also elided with these deities. We see this clearly in a Greek hymn to Isis inscribed at Medinet Mahdi, in which Isis's multiple names are praised, and I'm quoting from it here. The Syrians call you Astarte, Artemis, Anaya, the Lycian tribes call you Leto the Sovereign. The Thracians call you also Mother of the Gods, the Hellions call you Hera of the Great Throne and Aphrodite, and good Hestia and Thea and Demeter. But the Egyptians call you Theuis, because you alone are all other goddesses named by the races of men. So what these authors are proposing here is not a partnership, it's not a connection, but a full-on subsuming of several facets of Greek and Mediterranean divinity under one single godhead. Similarly, the final portion of the Marinia eratology's preserved text grounds Isis in the Greek natural and mythological landscape. First, the text describes Isis as residing in Egypt, but sharing her patronage with Greece. Devoting just five words to Isis's Egyptian home, the author minimizes her connections with Egypt. So you loved Egypt as your place of residence. You especially honored Athens within Greece. For there you made the earth produce food, tripped Ptolemos yoking your sacred snakes, scattered the seeds to all Greeks as he traveled in his chariots. That is why we wish to see Athens in Greece and in Athens Eleusis, believing the city to be the jewel of Europe, and that the sanctuary was the jewel of the city. So this concluding claim really cements Isis's relationship with Athens and the rest of Greece by describing her actually as the central goddess in the Eleusinian mysteries. And if you've ever read the Homeric Hymn to Demeter, you can already see the echoes here. First, the author promotes Triptolemos, the Eleusinian hero, as the first missionary of the Isiac religion. The final lines continue this theme, connecting Isis to Eleusis, Athens, and particularly the city Eleusinion. This sort of non sequitur between these two sentences is connected with a causal particle, toigarum, which sort of means accordingly. So thus these two concepts that appear really unrelated, her connection to Triptolemus and this desire to really go to Athens and see the city Eleusinion, become intimately intertwined. Triptolemus, his role as sort of this diffuser of Isiac cult, produces Isis's special role in connection to Athens and Eleusis, and as such recontextualizes Isis as a Greek goddess who's expected to appear and participate at key sites on Greek soil. This connection also has some resonances going back again to our dear friend Plutarch. Plutarch actually identifies Isis as a daughter of Cronos and Rhea, and therefore as a sister to Demeter, and he begins to separate Egyptian landscape from Egyptian geography in his texts, something that we will see in the material culture. He argues that Egyptian gods should be understood not only in terms of the marshes and the lotus flowers of the Nile, because this would deprive the rest of the world of Isis, where others lack the Nile or Buda or Memphis. Instead, the gods are the same among all people, whether Greek or barbarian. So this is a really interesting bit of deterritorialization. The gods now belong to a broader geographic landscape that is no longer limited to their traditional home in the Nile Valley. So taken together, these pieces of textual evidence show a common thread of deterritorializing Isis by separating her from Egypt and Egypt as a place. This shift is achieved by inserting her into Greek mythological genealogies and organizations of divine power. Now, it is strange to me that the Maronite Eratology places such emphasis on Isis's connection with Attica rather than Macedonia. Now, it's possible that this eratology is a copy of something that we lost from Athens, but surely it would not have been difficult to change this section to match up with a more local hero to make that adaptation. They've chosen not to. And so this connection with Athens was a choice that Maronian devotees must have seen as useful or profitable. Perhaps the Macedonian Isiac community wanted to continue to be tied more closely to the Attic one than we've previously assumed. All right, so the text of Plutarch also re-territorializes a part of Egypt that had really always very much fascinated Greeks, the landscape. As Plutarch indicated, Egypt's landscapes and its ties to Isis need to be shared by all of the world in order to be truly appropriate to this universalizing Greek version of Isis. I wish now to turn to this process of grounding, thinking about ways that Macedonian devotees use these ideas to build Isis's material world. Looking to sanctuary design, we can see that Plutarch's claims reveal a broader method of conceptualizing Isis in Egypt than perhaps we might have expected. In her recent book, Domesticating Empire, Caitlin Barrett takes an expansive sensorial assemblage approach to Pompeian gardens with Egyptianizing themes. By considering the sum effect of the garden's plants, water features, design, and decoration, she demonstrates that these spaces with Egyptianizing wall paintings often constructed an immersive experience that brought the viewer into the same space represented into the painting, that allowed visitors to feel as though they possessed and controlled a foreign space like Egypt. Of course, Egypt was not really all that foreign to Pompeians or other inhabitants of the Roman Empire. People of Egyptian origin or descent lived in many of the Mediterranean's port cities, Egyptian grain fed the empire, and there was a thriving tourism trade that brought the wealthy to Egypt. But familiarity does not always breed understanding. One need only look to American ideas of Mexico, as well as the tendency to subsume all of Central and South America into this idea of Mexico, to see that this kind of proximity often produces more stereotyping and ignorance, not less. So one of the sites where we can see this desire to reproduce and reground the Nile is at Dion, where the sanctuary to Isis was placed over a series of natural springs and along the Vafiris River. The site, which lay just outside of the city wall, would have been constantly filled with water and marshy plant life, as it still is today. The sanctuary was constructed in the 2nd century BCE over an existing sanctuary to Artemis Eleithyia. The sanctuary was renovated in the late Antonine or early Severan period, and probably again in the 4th century CE, though those dates and phases are contested. Sometime in the city's later history, the river changed course and the sanctuary was abandoned and silted up. The site remained more or less flooded into the 1970s when it was excavated using a complicated series of dams and pumps. This meant that excavation could not proceed according to normal guidelines, and part of the site was actually not excavated at all. Visitors to the site today can get a sense of why this site was chosen to construct this Nilotic atmosphere. The site remains flooded, and many small springs are still active, including one positioned directly underneath the base of a statue of Aphrodite that drains into a small pool. Archaeobotanical studies have not been done, and I'm not really sure how viable they would be given the current climate. So we cannot know if Egyptian plants or animals were used to further decorate the space. Martine Bomas has suggested that the Iseum Campanese in Rome would have had plants like papyrus and Egyptian animals, including birds and perhaps even crocodiles. Now, a crocodile seems very unlikely for Dion, but it's perhaps not unlikely that something like papyrus plants could have been planted in the sanctuary to further the effect. Now, outside of the natural landscape, several elements of the built environment in Dion's sanctuary contributed to this Nilotic environment. The sanctuary courtyard is divided by a pair of brick walls, approximately 1 meter tall. Though Inga Nielsen originally identified these as a processional route, excavator Dimitri Pandermalis actually indicated that they would have held water or otherwise replicated the Nile. This connection would have been solidified through sculptural decoration. A set of two marble bull statuettes was found at the east end of the feature. These closely copy other bovine figurines found at Rhodes and Gortina inside their water features, which were constructed in the form of the nilometer. So you can see one of these in the bottom right. A nilometer was a building in Egypt with a descending staircase and a water basin at the bottom used to measure the annual flood. Now, if you've ever been to Gortina, you know that there is no possibility of an annual flood in Gortina. It's very dry. There's actually a pipe over one of the niches that was meant to pipe in water to recreate this effect. But let's go turn back to the bulls here for a second. According to Wild, the gender of these cattle is actually quite significant for understanding their meaning and what they're trying to represent. But in any case, they do connect back to rituals of around water and around searching. So if these depict bulls, which it seems more likely, it is likely that they actually refer to the Egyptian bull god Apis and his chthonic connection with Osiris and the Nile's flooding patterns. If they are cows, the statues probably represent Isis or Isis Io, and Wild links them specifically to a rite described in Plutarch's De Aside, in which a cow is led 7 times around the temple of Helios in a ritual called the Search for Osiris. These bovine images could have also been brought into the water basin as part of that searching ritual, where the devotees found the god personified in the water itself. So the cattle themselves are also tied to the idea of the Nile and to the idea of participating in a Nilotic adventure. So these features then come together to reproduce this idea of the Nile. But it's important that we understand the cultural affordances that the Nile River held in the Roman Empire to really get at what people would have been experiencing as they walked into the sanctuary. There exists a very large corpus of paintings and mosaics found throughout the Mediterranean, including a handful of examples from domestic contexts in Greece, that represent Egypt in a stereotyped, imagined way. Vers Luis calls this type Nilotic, and he defines it as an iconographic representation of the natural world of the Nile in an ideal, abundant way that does not follow directly upon Egyptian antecedents. Scenes along the Nile often include recognizable plants and animals like hippopotami and crocodile and papyri, and they often convey these sort of highly stylized versions of the Nile, its banks, and the people, and imagine animals that are thought to dwell there. A lot of these include buildings, but nearly all of them are inhabited by this sort of stereotype race that has traditionally been called pygmies. These people engage in violent warfare and transgressive sex in ways that are semi-comedic. So this Nilotic is a fundamentally culturally and geographically oriented fantasy, an imagined landscape and world that brings far off Egypt into these very easily digestible spaces in other parts of the empire. Though there aren't any Nilotic scenes preserved at Dion or at any of the other Macedonian sanctuaries, it is very possible and I think likely that they did exist. Part of the overrepresentation of Nilotic scenes in Italy is due to the fact of, you know, they're all at Pompeii and in the Campanian cities and at Rome. And if you look elsewhere in the empire, and particularly in Greece, there's not that much wall painting that's been preserved. It's really an issue of archaeological preservation, I think, more than original distribution. So I think we should hold open the possibility that Macedonian sanctuaries might have had Nilotic decor like their counterparts at Ostia and Pompeii. So these kinds of images were produced in dialogue with a long-standing Greek interest in the Nile's natural landscape. In book 2 of Horace's Histories, we see that flora, fauna, land, and most importantly, the Nile itself, are vitally important to Horace's goal of communicating the marvelous nature of Egypt to his Greek readers. The book begins with a lengthy description of the Nile and a discussion of its peculiar properties, including its annual flood and its ability to provide Egyptians with crops without much toil. The ethnographic portion of book 2 ends with a description of aspects of life on the Nile, including the ways in which marsh dwellers turn the Nile's plants into food, controlled mosquitoes, built boats, and weathered the flood. In one section, Herodotus actually examines the Nile's fish with this inverted perspective that he uses to also describe humans. Female fish lead the school's homework, and male fish follow. Bassunia has pointed to this passage as an example of othering Egypt's natural environment as a way to construct narratives of alterity. And the rhetoric highlights these common themes in Herodotus' representation of Egypt, inversion, fecundity, marvelousness, and this preserved memory of a timeless ancient past. Now, many late classical and early Hellenistic authors critiqued Herodotus' representation of the Nile, but the prevalence of these critiques demonstrates that his views of Egyptian landscapes actually persist well into the imperial period. Eleni Manolaraki has looked at these representations and noted their ability to destabilize perceptions of space and time, to occupy a liminal space between familiar and foreign that, quote, telescopes space and time. So this Greek Nile is an inherently globalizing, deterritorializing force on its own. These visions of Egypt are deeply bound up in imperialism and the desire to control and ground this idea of the foreign in a safe, familiar space. Alongside their political dimension, these Nilescapes incorporate a partial knowledge of Egyptian cult practice and natural landscape with broader Greco-Roman ideas to produce what Barrett has called a, quote, spectacle of otherness. By building these types of sanctuaries that bring this replica of the Nile onto Greek soil, devotees are divorcing not only Egyptian religion and gods, but also Egyptian landscape from its original context. Their methods of grounding, which domesticate the Nile and render it something that Macedonians could safely touch, feel, and use, build this strong bond between Egypt and Macedonia. Devotees could walk out of everyday life in Dion and into a fantastical Egyptian world without even getting on a ship. So grounding Isis is not solely an exercise in environment. Devotees also use Greek materials and styles to ground the goddess in their artistic and cultural milieu. The Egyptian sanctuary at Thessaloniki, Macedonia's capital, preserves many examples of Isiac sculpture that depict the Egyptian gods in a decidedly Greek mode, as you can see here. First founded in 316 BCE, the partially excavated sanctuary contained at least two temples, a portico, and an altar, though the precinct probably contained several other structures. The sanctuary continued into use into the 4th century CE. So within this sanctuary were found 43 pieces of marble sculpture, 42 of which were made of white marble, one made of gray marble, and one further statue in a black Egyptian stone. The majority of this corpus is thus made up of ideal sculpture that we can group into two different categories: sculptures of the Egyptian gods carved in Greek style, as you can see here, and statues of well-known Greek deities that copy famous sculptural types. Now, there's one really important thing to note about these sculptures. Most of them are actually not produced in Macedonia or Thessaloniki. So for example, the Isis head that you're looking at on the left, it comes from Athens, and most of the stuff does. It's not local, and that's a really important part for understanding how we're going to ground Isis and Serapis specifically. So in these statues of Egyptian deities, the sculptures render Isis and Serapis in these very recognizably Greek forms. And one of the ways they do that is by borrowing poses and styles from familiar sculptures and adapting them to represent these new deities. So in this statuette of Harpocrates over here on the right, you can see how sculptors are innovating on the types used to depict Eros to create a new image of Harpocrates. So these, like Eros, Harpocrates is best known for his role as a child and as a god who can intervene in the day-to-day lives of devotees, though Harpocrates kind of lacks Eros's edge of mischievousness and danger. So he picks up on a lot of Eros's sort of iconography. He's sort of this pudgy small child with a rounded face, and some of these statues actually even have cuttings for wings in the back. But some aspects of Harpocrates' representation in Egyptian art has survived. Harpocrates here is holding his finger to his mouth in a shushing gesture known from Egyptian art that has no real meaning in Greek culture. This suggests that either artists or patrons at some point were aware of how the gods were portrayed in Egypt. But instead of importing these sculptures or the stones that they could have used to make them, these Macedonian audiences are strongly preferring to create these new Hellenized images of Egyptian deities that mostly pick up on Greek antecedents. Now, it's important to note that these images are also materially Greek. Apart from a handful of statuettes from Hellenistic Delos and Rhodes, there are no statues of Isis or Serapis that are made from Egyptian stone anywhere in Greece. These images are made almost exclusively out of white marble, sometimes from local sources, but most often imported from regionally significant places like Athens or occasionally Rome. Combining these elements borrowed from Egypt with this Greek artistic style and material creates a transcultural version of the Egyptian deities that does not deny their connections with Egypt, but chooses to emphasize their new status as a Greek deity. Now, it's important to think about, again, the choices that weren't made here. Sculptors could often paint statues to resemble imported stones, but there's no evidence to suggest that that's what's occurring here. Instead, I argue that the white marble was part of the meaning. During the Roman Empire, imported stones are often used to commemorate victories and represent the empire's growing control over distant territories and resources. Greek marbles, which are mostly found in shades of white, held pride of place due to their connections with earlier monuments that decorated Macedonian and particularly Attic cities. On the other hand, colored stones like the ones you see here, things like Egyptian red granite, were closely connected in literature with Roman control over vast geographic landscapes. Thessalonian statues of Isis could have made these claims. They could have emphasized Macedonia's participation in an imperial narrative. But instead, they chose to embody Isis in Greek materials, specifically often Attic materials, a choice that instead builds a connection with the Greek past and cemented their ties with Achaia, where this past was very fundamental to regional identity. So what then can we learn about deterritorialization in the Roman Empire from Issyic cults in Macedonia? Deterritorialization in this context was a process of rewriting Isis's past to place her in familiar and well-established Greek contexts and narratives. Macedonia's devotees constructed a new version of the Egyptian deities that had left Egypt to find a new home in Greek and Macedonian soil. The observations that I've made here highlight the fact that Macedonians were not interested in solely deterritorializing Isis, but in finding ways to ground her in Greece. I have traced their efforts through three types of material evidence: landscape, sculpture, and text. In the regard to landscape, I have shown that Egyptian cults were frequently set in sanctuaries that brought elements of the Egyptian landscape and territory into Macedonian towns. Macedonian devotees expanded great effort to build a small, domesticated, and imagined Egyptian world in which they could practice their devotion to Isis. This impetus takes multiple forms, whether it's environmental features like plants or natural springs, whether it's water features that replicate the Nile, or whether through sculptural decoration like the cattle, or potentially even through now lost wall paintings. In the realm of sculpture, Isis and her companions were reconfigured to lessen their attachment to Egypt and to embed them in Greek norms. As visualized in these statues, Isis and Serapis are enduring members of a Greek pantheon and visual culture. But this grounding is achieved through an eclectic combination of Greek artistic precedent, Egyptian symbolism, and skilled adaptation. Sculptures like those from Thessaloniki's Egyptian sanctuary depicted Isis and her companion deities in Greek styles, often borrowing from existing Greek types used to depict cognate deities. These artistic connections underscore the universalizing versions of Isis that were constructed in the Greek hymns used in Issyic rituals. The white marble of the sculptural program set up in these sanctuaries asked viewers to see Isis as one among many Greek deities. And the sculptural forms asked devotees to reach back into their own memories to draw theological connections between Egyptian and Greek gods. But together, the sanctuary and sculpture created a multidimensional landscape in which devotees could transcend their own location and place themselves in an imagined geographic fantasy. Now, the textual evidence I've surveyed offers us a further glimpse into this cognitive process. The poems which created new Greek families and histories for Isis and Egyptian deities were found at several Macedonian sites. These texts redefine Isis not only as a Greek goddess, but as a goddess who has been Greek, both by birth and by domicile, since the very beginning. The epigraphic hymns use the heightened experience of religion to prime devotees to see Isis in their region's myth history, to shift their understandings of the past, to incorporate Egyptian religion at the very core of Greekness. But these experiences also involve a certain amount of cognitive dissonance and memory experimentation. Devotees need to both remember the god's original context and at the same time be willing to forget just enough in order to accept Isis's grounding in a new place. Now, remarkably, the soil in which Egyptian deities were grounded did not always need to be Macedonian. As we saw in the Maronite hymn and much of the imported sculpture dedicated in Thessaloniki, a lot of the local connections are actually Achaean. The methods used to reconstruct the Nile have parallels throughout that region as well. This might suggest that Athens-centered Greekness, which was a highly valued cultural commodity in the Roman Empire, was valued in Macedonia as well. Now, this can be interpreted as a strategic appropriation. That is, Macedonians might have been claiming this type of Greekness to elevate their own status within the empire. But it also points to the larger and longer term issue of Macedonia's self-understanding as Greek. As early as the 5th century BCE, Macedonian kings had sought access to traditional Pan-Hellenic institutions like the Olympian Games and faced resistance, though they normally prevailed in the end. For many Macedonian elites then, arguing for a weak provincial boundary or attempting to erase that boundary altogether might have been especially attractive. In some sense then, Macedonian devotees were deterritorializing themselves. Instead of arguing for their own local peculiarity, much of the material culture I've looked at today argues for a new vision of geography where Macedonia's connections with Achaia and history of Greek culture were never in doubt. Deterritorializing Isis then was a process of redefining Macedonian identity as much as it was a way to incorporate Egyptian religion. It became a way to connect with higher status forms of culture and to build community with those who held more power on a Mediterranean-wide scale. Thank you.